In 1961, President Kennedy called on all Americans to rise to the challenges of the day. He knew that success depended upon the unity of efforts throughout the federal government and the nation. The Greater Boston Federal Executive Board, one of 28 across the country, fosters communication, coordination, and collaboration with federal, state, and local government agencies. This is your federal government, and I am your host, Diane LeBlanc. Hello, everyone. Today we are featuring the United States Department of Agriculture's Animal and Plant Health Inspection Service. For 41 years, the central mission of the Animal and Plant Inspection Service, also known as APHIS, has been protecting America's agriculture. And as America has changed, that mission has expanded. Today, in addition to protecting the health of livestock, poultry, and crops from foreign diseases and pests, the Animal and Plant Inspection Service helps to defend our environment from invasive species and protect our natural resources. While the name APHIS may not be well known to many Americans, the agency's work is seen and felt both far and wide. Today we are fortunate to have with us Mr. Clint McFarland, who is the project manager for the Asian Longhorned Beetle Eradication Program. And we are going to actually focus on that topic today. Mr. McFarland, welcome.
Thanks.
Thank you so much for being here. So you are part of the Department of Agriculture, and the acronym is APHIS.
It is APHIS,
Animal Plant Health Inspection Service. Okay, yes. So not again something that's commonly known. So talk a little bit about the mission of that service and where it fits overall in the Department of Agriculture. A little bit of history.
Sure. For the Department of Agriculture, you have quite a few agencies that encompass that. Maybe a lot of people don't think about that every day, but you've got the Food Safety Inspection Service. Mm-hmm. You got Food and Nutritional Services, which does all your SNAP and DSNAP when we have any emergency programs for getting food assistance to individuals. You also have the United States Forest Service that deals with all our wildfires that have been going on in the Southwest and out West over the past few years. Has been obviously big news, and that's all part of the Forest Service. APHIS is a different section of this. And so we look at, and rather large for the country, although people don't know about us as much, in making sure commodities, things that are getting certified to go both out of the country and into the country. This deals with quite a bit from the animal side. You mentioned poultry, livestock. We've got diseases that could come in that have over the past, exotic Newcastle disease, foot and mouth disease. We obviously have to look at these things. And then you have the whole plant side, all the crops with the global economy as it is now, sort of from the late 80s, early 90s, and how shipping of goods across this world, that also opens up that invasive seeds from weeds to plants to insects to diseases coming in this country. They've got an active transport mechanism. And so APHIS, we really safeguard America agriculture, whether that's on the livestock and the animal side or on the plant side. And that's going both ways. So we serve a rather large function for this country as far as industry is concerned and making sure these goods can get certified to move around the globe.
You actually have touched on many different functional areas. So you again sort of describe the Department of Agriculture overall, but then all of these different parts of your particular service. And in your job as project manager for the Asian Longhorned Beetle Eradication Program, did I get that right?
You did get that correct.
What is that a separate part of APHIS?
So yes, APHIS is broken down. So you've got animal health concerns, and that would be VS, which is our veterinary services. So looking at diseases that could come in, but also looking at the treatment of horses as they go around for different competitions and stuff in this country. So you've got different elements there. You also have on that side animal welfare. So any of the zoos are different things that are around. We have to look at these things, that the animals are being treated humanely, that their cages are clean, that they're not able to escape. All those kind of things still come in within APHIS as well. Then you have the plant health side, which is where plant protection and quarantine, of which I work out of that subset of APHIS, PPQ, plant protection and quarantine, and that looks after plant health. And they have control over excluding, eradicating, and or controlling insect pests, plant diseases, and things that might make it into this country for BPQ. Also under plant health, you have BRS, which is our biotechnology regulatory services. In this day and age of seeds, of different crops being treated actually with chemicals in their genome being added in to try to keep pests and things away from feeding on them, it's a new part of the world that we have to look at, and so that has to be regulated. You then go even further to look at our wildlife services. So things that are looking at damage, wildlife damage that's out there. One of our main examples of that is the brown tree snake in Guam, which has gotten rid of any birds, small rodents, anything else. It's on an island. The snake got introduced, and it's overwhelming everything else. Obviously, huge implications if that brown tree snake then makes it to somewhere like Hawaii, where you have so many commodities, so much that could get lost, not only from your commodities, but ecotourism and things like this, where you would be getting rid of what a lot of people would go to. There are a couple more here that we do have for APHIS as well, and that would be on top of that, any kind of some emergency support functions.
Okay.
An event like Katrina. Superstorm Sandy happens. You have displaced pets that are out there that need care. You might have flooding of crops, fields, also livestock might get into concern where they need to be moved around. All these kind of things, if it is with plant or animal health, we've got to come in there and help out. We also then have international services where we put people from APHIS out in Pakistan, in Brazil, in different areas to make sure we could help with their kind of commodities and our stuff making it into the country, whether that's a meat product or a plant product, but also then to help them certify things coming into this country to help out on that, just that trade and making sure that we can keep these businesses alive and vibrant for our economy. So quite a few things that APHIS does touch that people would not realize maybe day to day, but is always going on and constantly helping out the American citizen.
Well, and again, the impact on the economy of the things that you do and the reasons that you do them. Now, how long have you been with the agency?
I have been with APHIS and PPQ for 12 years.
Okay. And now PPQ, tell me what does that mean?
PPQ,
again?
Once again, is plant protection and quarantine.
Okay.
Yes.
Plant protection and quarantine. Okay. So your particular focus on the Asian longhorned beetle, how long have you been focusing on that? How long have you been the project manager?
I have been the project manager here in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts for the last 5 years, and that was since the onset of the infestation, when we were made aware of it. I have been up here overseeing operations. Before that, I was working on Asian longhorned beetle in the New York City metropolitan area and many of the boroughs of New York City, but I've been working solely on Asian longhorned beetle for APHIS and PPQ for the last 12 years.
Okay, so what does this effort look like in Massachusetts? First off, where are your offices located?
Yeah, we have 3 offices here in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. 2 in central Massachusetts, where we have the large problem in the Worcester County, so focused around the city of Worcester. We also have a smaller office in the city of Boston, close to Jamaica Plain, where we also had a small satellite infestation. We have quite a few people that work on this program. It is rather large. We've got 110 staff, whether from the state side or from the federal side, that are here and working on this project. We also augment with contractors to do our tree removals, our chemical treatment applications, to augment our surveys out there. And so you're adding about 100 additional staff from those contractors. So rather large in these aspects. When we look at this, infestations of Asian longhorned beetle have been in very urban settings in the past. The city of Chicago, New York City, very, very urban, where you don't have the threat. There's still a threat to the trees, but not to the larger ecosystem, to the northeastern hardwood forest. So here in central Mass was a much bigger concern to us because of what we're bordering up against, what we have to lose.
So I want to back up just a little bit, because we're moving real, real fast.
Oh, yes.
What is the Asian longhorned beetle?
Sure. The Asian longhorned beetle is a rather large, showy insect. They often call it the starry sky beetle from China. Almost looks like the night sky. You've got an onyx black coloration with white spots. It does look like almost a night sky. It's about 2 inches in length, so a rather large beetle that you're going to see. This beetle came from Pacific Rim nations, so China, Korea, Taiwan, and it entered into this country in solid wood packing materials, pallets for the most part. It is an insect that develops inside of wood, inside of a tree. It feeds on that cellulose material. No insects or creatures on this planet can really digest cellulose. So like a termite, it's got bacteria in its gut that allows it to do that. But it feeds on these trees to basically grow up, and that's what it develops on. So it attacks living trees. It will kill them, but that's how it develops. It made it in this country through commodities coming over. We didn't realize the threat and the impact of that, but now we've got this problem in our country for an insect that doesn't belong here, doesn't have any natural predators, and has a large appetite for the trees that exist around us.
And how many parts of this country has it been found in?
Sure, for Asian longhorned beetle, and it's been mostly from it moving here in solid wood packing materials around large shipping areas. New York City, metropolitan area, even going over to New Jersey, but almost intact there for how goods move around. The city of Chicago. Now we have central Massachusetts around the city of Worcester and also in Boston, a small one. Recently as well in Ohio, in a small town called Bethel, Ohio, which is just southeast of Cincinnati. Okay. And then in North America, that's in the United States, we also had Toronto, where commodities were coming in, where the Canadian Department of Ag had to deal with a very similar thing to what we did.
Okay. And your focus is, again, in Massachusetts, but you mentioned five states where it exists. And two of the states have already, the federal government has already been successful in eradicating this problem. Talk about that.
Yeah, we just did New Jersey on March 14th.
Okay.
Just here very, very recently that it was declared eradicated. All our regulations were lifted. Chicago actually happened in 2008. So we do have a proven methodology now that we just have New York, Massachusetts, and Ohio still remaining here in the continental United States for these kind of infestations. But with that, for the boroughs of Staten Island and Manhattan, they're both very close to having their eradication ceremonies. So we have a proven methodology that works, and we know that, so we know that we can achieve our mission. We know that the goal, the target that we have set, we can achieve, even with developing emerging technologies always coming up, that we can become more efficient, but we know it's been proven in the past.
So I want to come back and talk more specifically about sort of the proven method for eradication in a little bit. But focusing back again on Massachusetts, this is a serious problem for the Worcester community. And when did it first show up in Worcester?
It was first found by a resident, which most of our North American infestations have been found by residents just being concerned, in August of 2008. That's when we were made aware of it. The little thing concerning about the infestation here in central Massachusetts is that it is the largest in the country as far as numbers of trees infested. There is a larger geographic area in New York City out to Long Island just on square mileage, but this is the largest as far as numbers of infested trees and really for what we have to lose.
So, and how many trees did this mean for Worcester?
Right now, as far as numbers of trees, in the almost 5 years that we have been here, since it started in the onset in August of 08, we have removed 32,000 trees individually for infestation. Plus, on top of that, and I should mention, it's been an additional 1,000 acres that have been removed as a complete host removal, more of a forestry operation around that. So that is many other trees in addition to that, but it's significant on the impact to the community, but for what we have to lose, it's necessary.
So you said that it was brought to your attention by a resident back in 2008. So at that time, an office didn't exist in Boston. How did the federal government respond to that?
Yeah, in Boston and Worcester, APHIS was not here.
Okay.
We come in because of the actual risk, and then once it is eliminated, we will pack up and move out again. We are here solely to mitigate against the Asian longhorn beetle infestation. It was actually brought to our attention by a resident that was scared because it was a large showy insect. It was actually a grandmother thinking it was going to attack her grandchildren.
Wow.
She went onto the internet, saw it was wanted by the government. Her husband and friends, of course, laughed at her and laughed at her, saying, sure, this insect. She was very persistent. She didn't stop. And she did notify us. After we got that phone call and pictures and spoke with her, we had boots on the ground within 24 hours, wow, already working with the local municipalities for office space, for telling them what we needed, already bringing in temporary people because you wouldn't have the funding at that point. But we have an expertise, and we tell everybody in APHIS, we're an emergency support function agency. As soon as something like this happens, for anything that happens in the country, we know as part of our charter that we can get pulled out at any time to move into starting up this kind of work, because you need to start immediately. But we had people here quickly, housed in with the city of Worcester for many months until we could get our own space to work in, but had to start that work immediately.
And I want to come back and elaborate on that as well in just a little bit. But you said when it was found in 2008, that it had probably been out there for a while.
Oh, yes.
Since that this was the largest infestation, you know, identified. How long do you think it was there that it went undetected?
When I look back at this infestation, I think all the infestations in North America pretty much came around the same time, late 80s, early 90s.
Wow.
And this was at the really when the global economy really started to explode and goods and commodities were being shipped all over in a very quick fashion. So I think it goes back to that. I think this is more an awareness of what we have to lose, of what's actually in the ecosystem, what's around us, mm-hmm, what's native. Looking at all these services that are provided that for our livelihoods that make us able to live in these different environments. It's very, very important for us. So I think it's more an outreach and awareness because it had been out there. Yeah. We have been educating even people in industry, let alone the public, but you can never do enough of that is what I see. You can never do enough of sort of making people more cognizant of their surroundings.
So you talked a little bit about how the problem was identified. The federal government wasn't here. APHIS wasn't here doing this work, but you came in and responded to the problem. Just sort of, you know, stepping back and looking at that, why didn't Worcester deal with it? Or why didn't the state deal with it? Why did they need the federal government?
And that's a good question, because these they can in their own fashion, but when you look at that, you need a coordinated effort for something like this. The biggest thing that I think about in those kind of regards is you need to be able to enter people's properties, their private properties, in order to do survey. That's why we as the federal government always come to partner up with the state. They have more of that jurisdiction, the authority to go onto people's properties for this. The Plant Protection Act of 2000 does protect the federal government to do that work, but we would rather go in with the assistance of the state in order to do that. Because this insect, and because you have a huge regulatory concern on its inside firewood, when you cut down this material inside these trees, you might not know an insect is still in there. We don't burn firewood immediately. We will allow that to cure, to dry out enough. With this insect taking about a year to develop inside that tree, it takes that long, that still gives enough time for it to move around. So the big thing we always worry about is the insect moves on its natural dispersal, not so far, not so quickly. But we as humans in an infested piece of firewood can move that overnight anywhere basically we want to, which is a very real concern. And I think that's more where you need the federal sides to come in with the state to look at that intrastate, the interstate movement, to have jurisdiction capacity to seize that material, and that's going outside of your local municipality that would stop at its borders. We, of course, that doesn't mean we don't partner up. You've got to partner up with the local state reps and state senators, to the local city councilors, selectmen, town managers, all important to make sure there's a transparency. Everybody knows why we have to do the work we have to do. Then you can also get the reverse 911 calls. You can get on their cable access networks. You can spread the word, going back to that outreach that's absolutely important to make people aware. But it's got to be a combined effort. That's why we say it's a cooperative program. There's no way that the federal government can do it alone, the state government alone, but that's where we see that you need to have all parties at the table. And we bring a certain expertise to the table too, for the federal government, of a knowledge about this pest. A lot of people that have studied it for a great many years, both in China, here in quarantine facilities here in North America, working with the Canadian Department of Agriculture, who had worked on this before, but using that expertise. And I should also say that the federal government can also triage that then with the European Union nations. We in the United States are not the only ones dealing with Asian longhorn beetle. With these commodities moving from these Pacific Rim nations, the European Union, England just got it last year, Switzerland, Italy, Germany, a lot of these countries are dealing with the same thing. It's not just isolated to us here, but then you can start to look at what other people are doing, share information, share the research and different emerging technologies that are going on, so it becomes a lot more collaborative, and that is all useful when we're battling an insect pest like this.
So we mentioned earlier that in Illinois and in New Jersey, it's been eradicated.
Yes.
How is this problem eradicated?
Sure. So when we go out there, you have to identify where the insect is. The first thing you have to do, survey for us, informs everything. So you have men and women with binoculars on the ground that will go look for the egg sites that the female Asian longhorn beetle will chew into the tree to lay her egg, and also the emergence holes. The emergence holes that we do find, we say the eraser end of a pencil test can go into them. It is going to be that big. You have to think an insect, unlike ourselves, has an exoskeleton. Their skeleton is on the outside. So as soon as they fully develop inside that tree, they have to have a hole completely for that, because they're not malleable. They won't be able to bend like us. That whole insect has got to, so it's got to be completely cylindrical on its way out. We differentiate that versus a sapsucker, a woodpecker, bird damage. It's going to be much more conical in shape based after their beak. So it will be completely cylindrical going in. One thing that really differentiates this versus a lot of other damage you might see on trees. So we send these men and women out to look on the ground. You also have men and women that do our aerial surveys. So they actually climb on ropes, go up into the tree to look at every single part of that tree all the way through the canopy. They will look all around every single part, which is necessary for us. This is a very tedious process. Since we have been here for the last 5 years, we have looked at over 3.5 million trees. When I talked about what we removed, 32,000, 3.5 million just speaks to, because that's only in the immediate Worcester County area. That's not going out into the forested areas that surround that. So you've got a large, large task of identifying where the infestation is. As soon as you would find something that is infested, we cut it down, we remove it. We grind, we chip that material, we grind the stump. You have to get rid of everything. That's our absolute way when we're eradicating.
So the tree can't be saved?
The tree cannot be saved. We take it all down. That is our property at that point, and we will remove it. We do have a replanting program. We work very cooperatively with the state. We have brought in already $5 million for replanting on the program thus far, and another $5 million are coming into play right now, both from federal and state sources. But that is, you've got to be the healing process. That brings back the urban forest with much more vigor, more robust, much more diversified. I mean, we've gone through chestnut blight, Dutch elm disease. Now, when we came into the city of Worcester, this insect loves maple trees. 77% of the street trees were Norway maples, all planted in the 60s. We need to move away from that monoculture. Any kind of pest or disease comes in, it just has carte blanche to move right through that. So we remove these trees. Another couple things that we do are chemical treatment applications. After you have identified areas where infested trees have been removed, we know that looking at these trees is tedious. You look at them in different seasons and multiple occasions with multiple eyes, but still there's that human error. So with the chemical treatment applications, it still is a pesticide. There's obviously ramifications from that. We only want to use it where necessary. It's not a silver bullet, because it's not 100% for how it interacts with the physiology of the tree. But with that, it can help as protect other susceptible trees around there. We don't want to just spread that everywhere, because once again, it is a pesticide. But with that, it can give us other protection that's out there. On top of that, you also have trapping. We've had detector dogs that have been out there. You use different means to help find, to augment that survey, but it really goes survey, removals, chemical treatments are our three big operations that lead us to eradication.
So in Massachusetts, again, the focus has been in Worcester, and there's been one other area, and we will talk about that shortly. But other communities in Massachusetts, do you spot check those? Do you rely upon the local officials who are responsible for, you know, the forestry division in their town or community to, you know, understand what they're looking for? Do you do training for them? I mean, how are you covering the entire state?
Sure, and there's a ton of outreach, and this goes back again that we can't stop, especially with the parks departments, DPW departments, the public works, all that. We do reach out to, you sort of do it more so in our impacted area, the 110 square miles that are regulated right now in central Massachusetts, but you do go outside of that. We work with the Department of Conservation and Recreation and also the Department of Agricultural Resources here in the Commonwealth to do a lot of that outreach, to go and help facilitate where we can't always be there, but you've got to get to these departments. We also open up, then we have our AsianLonghornBeetle.com site where people can upload pictures. You can just type us a message telling us. We've got now on social media, but we get out there as much as we can. We've got hotline numbers. We send people out. Since I have been here in the past 5 years, just in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, we have done over 10,000 service calls. Wow. A service call I treat as if somebody calls up with, okay, there's some suspicious damage on my tree, or I have a suspicious insect. With that, we've been from P-Town up to North Adams, and that's just here in the Commonwealth because we do triage those as the cooperative eradication program, but we have others that can help us, but everything comes back so that we can do that education to speak to them about what they are seeing. And we don't care. We tell them if the insect is smashed to pieces, I can still tell from those pieces that you have left what it was. Take a picture, throw it in the freezer. Anything in this day and age, there's so many ways that you can get to us, but that's what we need to do. And that's just here in the Commonwealth because we do interact with the forestry departments, with industry in the surrounding New England states, inclusive of New York State as well, because there's a lot to lose right and there. People realize what's to lose. And so they're always asking. We're constantly giving updates. They want to know. Firewood has been cut off for movement in the surrounding states as well. Even Maine this past year did a exchange program where anybody coming across the border to come up for our hunting and fishing and recreational activities, that they took it out. They had police barricades there. They seized the wood but gave you something else. We're really going more to that buy local, burn local. You really don't want to move it.
And that really is a significant key. You've brought some samples. Mm-hmm. So tell me what we have here.
Sure. So maple is the most preferred. Okay. They absolutely loves maple, which is a big concern to us, any variety, but you're also seeing some birch pieces here. We can look at these pieces of wood, and what we are seeing on here when we look are these chew marks. You can see chew marks.
Absolutely.
And you can see the serrations on the outside of this, where that's where the female, that's the oviposition pit, that's the egg site. The female will come here, and you can see some are a little bit fresher. Mm-hmm. When this tree was removed, cut down because of the damage, you could see a tree just like us has an immune system. Okay. So this is a little bit more bruised on the immediate. After a while, that weathers. It becomes more grayed out where you can't see it as much, but you can still see the serrations. So the female will come up to this tree and chew these pits. She will stick her ovipositor underneath the bark here. That's how she has to chew the pit. But so the egg is protected. The egg is laid on the underside of the bark when it will start to develop inside of there. So one thing we will look for when our inspectors are out there in the field are these egg sites. Okay. And these egg sites, although you might think versus other insects that are out there, well, the more you look, just like the more you study anything, it becomes night and day. Yeah. Just looking at trees are very, very different, where some people that don't know might come up to a tree, oak, maple, it all looks the same. Very, very different on bark, buds, structure. Wow. But this we can very much tell. Yeah. Then it will develop. The insect will develop internally in the tree. And as I said, it takes at least a year. Wow. At least a year for that to go to the egg all the way up to the adult and come back up. At least a year, could take 2 years at this latitude. So that's what gives us a fighting chance to get rid of this insect because it's not multiple generations per year, it's just one. You could see from the side here of it feeding through the tree. So all this is damaged from Asian longhorn beetle during that year from when it's feeding through there, and then it will come out. And these are the holes. Absolutely perfect. This sample here actually shows you really nice, but absolutely perfect. Wow. And it's sort of what I say as well.
You said the pencil eraser.
Yep, the eraser end of a pencil test. And you can see here a little bit of a difference on a male, a little bit smaller, female. Yeah. Once again, they have that skeleton on the outside. The female has to have a little extra room for when she becomes pregnant. They can't just expand at that point. So we will also look for these. Absolutely perfect, almost like somebody edged, a landscaper edged the side of a driveway. You will see no cracking or anything around the side of this, which is very typical of Asian longhorn beetle, versus you'll get vertical and horizontal cracking for a lot of other insects that are out there. There are many, many, an Asian longhorn beetle is called a cerambycid. That's just a longhorn beetle. They all feed on wood. We have got over 230 species here in New England that are part of our ecosystem. They serve vital functions. Right. We just... So you will see other holes out there in the woods. Doesn't mean it's all Asian longhorn beetle, but very, very distinctive on how this is coming out. So we will look for these emergence holes. You will look for these egg sites on the tree. That's what our inspectors are doing out there. And I can just show you here a little bit for, once again, you got the egg sites, you got the eggs that look almost like the grain, the size of a grain of rice, your emergence holes, you got your male and your female, once again, looking like the starry sky beetle, you got your striated antenna, you've got that on the back there, that onyx color with the, you know, the white spots, that white spots. You got the male and the female, male a little bit smaller, male's antenna is gonna be a little bit longer to get attracted to the female, chemically to find each other. You're seeing some of the damage. Frass is in the middle here.
Okay.
Frass is our glorified entomological word for excrement. They cannot digest all that cellulose material.
Okay.
So the bacteria in their guts helps, but that's all coming out what they can't digest.
Yeah.
We look at this because this versus a carpenter ant, carpenter bee,
you can tell.
Very, very different. That carpenter ant, carpenter bee is gonna be very, very, fine, almost like you're working in your a wood shop, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You're working in your garage. This is very coarse, very stringy. You might not think, but once again, like the damage to the tree, you can tell that that's Asian longhorn beetle. Then you're gonna see here, the immature. That's an immature, and you could see that this larva is about 2 inches in length. When you think about that feeding inside of a tree, what that will do to the structural integrity, it's going to absolutely compromise that. So this also becomes a health and human safety hazard. When I first arrived in Worcester for this program, we had that ice storm event that was, I've never seen anything like it from that winter of 08 into 09. You had a quarter inch of ice encapsulated on all this.
Yeah.
That's when, before we got to remove any of that, we were still just identifying in that first 4 months going into our removal operations, but that, because the structural integrity from Asian longhorn beetle wasn't there, you had tops of trees, you had limbs falling left and right. Very, very scary. A big cost too for any kind of homeowners or anything at that point. I don't know if you've ever gone to see and do some tree pruning or tree removals. It is not the most inexpensive of things. And if we hadn't been here to sort of assist with that as well, or it hadn't been in combination with the Asian longhorn beetle, I mean, limbs were gonna come down anyway, but from this, they were just, it was gonna exacerbate the situation immensely.
So sort of on that point, I mean, again, the regulated area you said was 110 miles?
110 square miles right now
in
central Massachusetts, and that grows.
And homeowners that have trees that are infected, is there any cost at all to homeowners for the tree removal?
Absolutely not.
Okay.
We take on all the cost of this. We need to get this material out. We need to excise out that population of this invasive insect pest. So there's no cost to them. And we work very closely with them. If we need to make an appointment on the removal of that tree, it becomes, and we have to be ultimately empathetic. Some of these trees were planted for very specific reasons too. Heating, I mean, we educate after the fact of the heating and the heating and cooling costs and what you can save. Two, do you want a different aesthetic value to a bloom during different part of the season? Because even on that replanting, none of that cost goes to the homeowner.
Okay.
All that comes back to us, we will plant it. The only thing we ask after the fact is that tree won't survive unless you water it. They just have to water that tree and, you know, care for it. But we like to have that whole conversation about what are the benefits of trees? What does this mean? And I think with a very unfortunate circumstance and being empathetic to their situations, because it's not easy to see your property that you've known devoid of trees now, but bringing that back is where we need to be, and having that conversation is very, very important.
I'm sure that the residents of Worcester are all very familiar with what to look for. They know what the insect looks like, and you've done a good job here sort of explaining things to our viewers. But for the other communities in Massachusetts, again, what is it if they're inspecting their trees? First off, they should be inspecting their trees. They should be looking at them. What's the one thing that they should be looking for?
Just look for
the big clue.
Those abnormalities. Really what you can find, that frass material that I was just showing you, if you have a heavy infestation on that, what you call the crotches, where your limbs of your tree will come off, that frass will collect there. It'll collect at the base of the tree. When I first went out to see the infestation that was in Boston, that frass material, I could pick it up in handfuls, almost looked like mulch at the base of the tree, but it wasn't mulch. It was coming out of there. Really, other things that can draw your eye are these emergence holes. If you're seeing that it looks a little bit like Swiss cheese, that's a problem. But these are abnormal things. If you're looking at your tree and you know, it's just something that should draw your attention, this isn't right. Another thing during the season, because these insects are digging into the tree, whether on the egg site or on the emergence hole, because that sap is flowing through the tree now for the spring to the summer, a lot of that will be a weeping, what we call bleeding of the tree. And because that's sugary, that sap, it'll attract bees, moths, butterflies, a lot of other insects going to a part of your tree. Should draw your eye to what's going on there. And that's not to say that a squirrel or something couldn't have scratched it, but it will draw your eye because a lot of other things will be collected to it. And we always want to hear from you. If you're taking a look and you're just not sure, I would love to send out some of our inspectors to have
when
a conversation.
Yes,
always, where you can always reach out to us. We would love to do that just so you're more aware of what you're seeing. And I think that education is just an important thing.
So you mentioned, again, just a few seconds ago, Boston. Mm-hmm. And when I was doing my research to prepare for today, I read about the half dozen trees that were identified over in Jamaica Plain.
Yes.
And the good news is that problem no longer exists. So tell us, you know, how was that identified? What did you do? And how quickly was that isolated?
Sure, this is one of our best success stories, and so we really love it. And also, I should step back to say, all our North American infestations were found by residents. Residents. We have always been trying to get industry, different people in industry, because they're the ones looking at trees every day to become more involved and get that, and we did get that with Boston. From the outreach and everything we were doing in central Massachusetts, that has to always be a big push. Mm-hmm. The facilities manager at Faulkner Hospital actually gave us a call because she found that the trees, she thought they looked suspicious. Yeah. So I got pictures on a Friday night leading into the 4th of July holiday. I knew they didn't look good, so I was out there with my wife on Saturday.
Wow.
We went out for the day and looked, and we actually found the 6 red maples at the entrance to Faulkner Hospital that were there. I got other people to come out on Sunday. We were then again there on Monday, since it was the holiday, doing the inspection. So we were on the ground immediately. We had the knowledge to deal with this, trying to see how extensive, because you do have the Arnold Arboretum with some of the most prized trees in the country for their lineage, right across the street, right across center. I mean, you look right down the hill there, and you're in the Arboretum. But very, very glad that we got these. We had the press conference with Mayor Menino, some of the other from the Secretariat, from Deval Patrick's administration that we did, and everything was pulled together. We had those trees removed on that Tuesday morning.
Wow.
The biggest thing for this is when I was there on that Saturday, there were no fresh emergence holes from that year 2010.
Okay.
Back on Monday, we did see 2 fresh emergence holes. We captured both of those beetles. We actually found them on the trees, captured them. So we knew no other insects had come out for that summer. When we started removing the trees, we saw that there were 30 adults literally days away from emerging, and plus a bunch of other larvae and immatures that were going to come out that summer. We would have been in a very different place if that outreach hadn't worked, if the facilities manager hadn't called us in
quick.
A timely fashion, if we hadn't responded that quickly, got to the city, everybody else that needed to be made aware of the problem. But we have removed those 6 trees. This is the only infestation for Asian longhorn beetle in North America where we've had a single point source because we caught it that timely. So we can't speak highly enough of, you can do this.
That's amazing.
Proven, and you can get that. We have looked at, we talked about the 3.5 million trees in central Massachusetts. We have looked at 100,000 trees surrounding this in the town of Brookline, in the city of Boston, radiating out from that.
Right.
Nothing else has been found. Wow. Very good signs. And so for that, we're looking at that. How much further do you need to go?
Right.
Is that one almost wrapped up because you found it in such timely fashion?
Absolutely. Yes. I was going to ask you what a typical day was like for you, but that's pretty incredible.
Yeah.
Now, so again, 4th of July weekend, that's not a typical day.
No.
What is a typical day like for you?
A typical day, we, with all the employees that we talked about, we will have our morning musters with everybody, talk about any new announcements, anything, but get our crews together, get everybody lined up, get them out there. We want to make sure. A typical day for me, we could be fielding calls. We need to speak a lot, as I talked about, with the town managers, with our partners, strategizing on message and getting out there. But you're going to be a lot of overseeing the crews. We've got aspects with all those people for surveys, both aerial and ground functions of that. We have enormous amount of data coming in that needs to be overseen as far as that incoming, that data to make sure it's the quality is good, and then the post analysis of that. We keep GIS maps live for any lat long for any of the trees that are out there, basically serial tagging mm-hmm. them. You have got our quality assurance and quality control programs, not only for our own staff, but for our contracted staff to make sure that they're at the level that we need to see the quality of the work out there. You speak a lot with residents and other stuff that I do drawing in. When they do get upset about people being on their properties, understanding mm-hmm. why right, a tree has to come
of
down.
Course.
I mean, I do step right. forward a lot in that mm-hmm. to go out. And that's part of the empathy and what we have to do mm-hmm. is to, if that entails going out in the evening when they're home, to have a mm-hmm. face-to-face. And a lot of this we do wow. now more on a case-by-case. But in the beginning, that was every single evening that I was here for the first year I was here was to be that transparent, whether it's a public town hall meeting, whether it's a small organizational group getting together to get the word to them, or if it's just going and having tea with a homeowner just to speak about and to let them understand, because they have to, if they don't understand why we're doing it and why it's so important and how it touches a great many people's lives. I mean, this just isn't industry when we look at what Asian longhorned beetle has to touch. I mean, the service industries, all the vibrant colors from the fall, all the leaf peepers are coming up for these trees that the Asian longhorned beetle loves.
You don't think about that.
You got the sugar maple. Yeah. I mean, the industries there of maple syrup to a bunch of other things, and that's not going into your ecological and environmental factors as well, your carbon sink, your air quality, your water quality. I mean, we're there in central Massachusetts right on the Wachusett Reservoir that's coming from the Quabbin that's down to Boston for the water source. So just, there's larger impacts that people, you know, and thinking about, but getting this message out, you've been here 5 years now, and I often thought before that maybe that goes away after some time. No, that outreach and awareness has always got to escalate up. But overseeing these operations, making sure that all our partners are aware of anything we're doing, setting up a lot of those meetings, and I hate to say that maybe some of this is more meetings and conference calls, but that goes to that transparency.
But
making sure everybody is aware, because really, none of this should blindside anybody. We have a protocol. We know what we're doing, and we can message that.
That's it. And you said earlier, you the problem exists. You come in, you eradicate the problem, and then you leave. How close are we to being able to say that the problem's been eradicated in Worcester?
In Worcester, it's still going to take more time. Boston is coming up actually quickly, and we like that, because it's not a one-size-fits-all for Asian longhorned beetle infestations. You really have to take all that information, size, scope, scale, really what we have to lose out there and what we should be putting our resources in. Right now in the past, we have done many, many different survey cycles. It was a protracted amount of time, but we know it was proven. Now we know we can realize many, many efficiencies analyzing the data, knowing how this insect finds its trees, knowing its different pathways and mechanisms, doing that. Right now, we have been here 5 years. I imagine that we'll need another decade to truly eradicate. Okay. But that should be tearing down over time, because you shouldn't have any more infested tree removals here over the next couple years. That should be it. And then with really eradication, you're doing confirmation surveys. You're out there just making sure
that,
that nothing was left. And you've got to give a population of insects to build a little bit of time, but with 3.5 million trees and growing, we haven't looked at everything we need to yet. That also can't be done overnight if you're going to do it appropriately. But looking at about another decade, but a lot of people joke, hey, you're putting yourself out of a job. That's the whole point.
But that's it.
That's the whole point is to do this. And with this day and age, you've now got emerald ash borer that's out in the Berkshires, moving its way through the Commonwealth and through New England. There's always something else we could look at. APHIS is that big that there's always another concern.
And you said you've been doing this for about 12 years?
Yes.
And what is your background, and how did you come to work for the federal government?
Yes. we often talk about that as children, we don't have that inherent fear of insects. They just are. A lot of people grow into that. I never grew out of that stage. All throughout high school and everything else, I very much was in love with insects and did a lot of work on stream ecology that led to how the water quality and different tests that you could do in developing nations that were easy enough that you could tell if industry, if you were polluting your streams just by the insects that live in them as immatures before they come out. Always had loved that. Had thought a lot about maybe going into the medical fields, had worked in my undergraduate down at the CDC doing a lot of AIDS research and different stuff like that, but found that I still had that love for insects. So I went on to graduate school to become an entomologist, and I focused on biological control of invasive insect pests. So going actually that involved into it, and I've had a love. I worked right out of graduate school in Florida on citrus crops, on a little insect, a little plant hopper called the Asian citrus psyllid. and that's actually transmitting a very bad disease on fruit on citrus called the greening disease. They call it greening because the fruit never ever ripens. And by the time they find out, you basically have to burn your whole grove
your
to
crop.
Get rid of it. Yes, a very big problem as the citrus industry from Florida to Arizona to California is many billions of dollars in an industry in this country. But I'd fallen in love with that and then looked. I didn't know what APHIS was prior to coming out. And I found out what they did and sort of it lined right up.
Yeah.
And so that's how I got in after working with the Asian citrus dealer there in Florida to focusing on Asian longhorned beetle. And it has been my life and something I've been thinking about maybe too much, but for the last 12 years.
Clearly your passion.
Yeah.
Now, the team of folks that you work with, do they have similar backgrounds?
We have a wide variety of backgrounds, but you've got a lot that are in science, but that's going from botany to horticulture to forestry type things. We also bring in a lot of people that don't have just that scientific. I think it's good to be well-rounded in our office. Mm-hmm. You have got a great many students that are just coming out of and graduating from university, so very young. We've got people on the second and third parts of their careers, but I love that, that you get that experiential knowledge with some new people just coming out. You do have a lot of science. You do have a lot of science that complements around. It's not all entomology, and I like to see that some's just a general biological science, but as I said, some coming out of engineering and different things, that this is just different parts of their career, because we've got some people that actually came out of retirement. They were with a bunch of environmental groups in the area and volunteering as it was, and they said, I care so much about my community that this is that big that I want to be part of it. And we like to see that too. That's just bringing in people that are just passionate about what we're doing and our mission.
A career that you would recommend to others?
Oh, I think so. I try to talk to a lot of people now, because I think that they had shied away from environmental careers and different things before. And I like to tell people that you can follow a dream, a passion, something that you just really enjoy. It can almost be your work and your hobby can be very closely related. And I tell a lot of people, why not follow that? Because you can find those things. And I think you can get a lot more enjoyment out of it, because it's not just punching a clock. It actually means a lot more. And for what we're doing to have that every day is worthwhile, I feel.
And clearly, this is your passion, and you obviously love it, which is why I think you're probably so good at it. Now, what have we not told our viewers that they need to know about the Asian longhorned beetle?
We hit on it. I just always like to come back is that buy local, burn local. The movement of firewood, being chivalrous and leaving firewood at a campsite really has severe ramifications. Mm-hmm. Taking wood to your friend's house, to grandma and grandpa's house, it might seem innocuous enough, but it really has dire ramifications for something like this. It's not just Asian longhorned beetle now, it's emerald ash borer that's coming in through the west. Same thing, an insect that develops internal in wood and can become a very big problem. But also, get out there and look. You're walking your dogs. You frequent your favorite parks. You're out there picnicking as we head on to the spring and summer months. Be observant out there of your surroundings and call us. I say that the best thing that we have, and as a tool, and we didn't mention this yet, are the citizen scientists. Are the people out there looking in your community, discussing it, looking at what's around you. You probably, a lot of people probably have a street tree, municipal tree, or a park they like to frequent. Just take a look. And as I said, a lot of these things, they will look like abnormalities. It just is not going to look like the trees you're used to. So give us a call. We're always willing to hear in the citizen scientists for each and every one of us. It's within us. And that's how we're going to solve these problems.
Everybody can be a citizen scientist.
Everybody.
I love it. Yeah. I love it. That was great. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right. So I want to thank Clint McFarland for being with us today and for helping us to better understand the work of the United States Department of Agriculture's Animal and Plant Health Inspection Service and the role it plays as a protector of American agriculture and our natural resources. I thank you for watching, and I hope that you will continue to join us as we feature other federal agencies on your federal government.
for as long as we can remember. Trees have watched over us. Now it's time to keep an eye out for them. Look for and report the Asian longhorned beetle.